The Financial Survival Network, helping you to survive and thrive in the new economy.
This is the Financial Survival Network.
Financial Survival Network is presented to you by Regal Assets. Buy and sell physical gold and silver through your existing retirement plan, 100% tax-free with Regal Assets. If you want to include physical gold or silver in your existing IRA or old 401k, request your free investment kit, which was recently featured in the Forbes and Smart Money Wall Street Journal magazines. Call toll-free 855-678-6620, 855-678-6620, or visit regalassets.com. We all know there's a lot of uncertainty in the world, which is why we're giving you as much information as we can, and we get voices from all over. I've got Professor Joel Stern. He's an author. He's currently teaching economics at the University of South Africa. He's here to talk about the rule of law, what benefits it gives, and where it's threatened today. Professor Stern, welcome to the financialsurvivalnetwork.com.
It's a pleasure to be with you, especially coming from Cape Town, South Africa.
Yeah, you're like a long way off, but at least you're having a nice winter, I hope.
There's not a cloud in the sky. The temperature is 64 degrees, and it's wintertime. And there's never any humidity here, so it's absolutely gorgeous. But please don't tell anybody. We hope that there are not too many listeners to your program, because if there are, they're going to want to come here. It's going to get very crowded.
Yeah, well, we've got thousands of listeners, so I don't know how many. I don't know how many are willing to just sell the farm and move. There's probably a few out there.
Well, I come here actually 5 times a year. I've had the pleasure of teaching at the University of Cape Town since 1978, and I also teach at other schools. Like at my home base is Columbia University in New York, where I'm during the year, and also at the University of Chicago in Chicago. But let me say that it's a pleasure to be here. And the subject that you have today, this issue of rules and regulations and governance in a sense, it is the area of research that I've spent most of my time on.
And that's why we have you on, because in the U.S., many of us fear, myself in particular, that the rule of law is eroding, that we're getting the rule of man and the regulatory democracy that we have in place, and I think that's a contradictory term, but regulatory yeah. agencies are anti-democratic, anti-rule of law, because many of the rules that they pass through a process that's open, supposedly, are really the antithesis of blind justice, aren't they?
Yes, but that's one of the reasons why we have frequent elections. The electorate is free to toss them out and put somebody else in their place who will have greater respect for private contracts. Incidentally, the major issue is this. If two people engage in a contract for mutual benefit, not only do they benefit, but the entire society benefits. They hire people. The typical company, for every $1 of sales, the profits that go to the owners is only about 6 cents. All the other 94 cents go to all kinds of other people in the society, from the companies that produce products, or the ones that ship products, you just name it. There are jobs being created all over the place, okay? So the best that we've been able to come up with in our world is that we have a free market system where there's competition, which is what controls the temptations of some people to either dilute their product or misrepresent or whatever. Obviously, if they do a bad job, then they're going to not have a reputation and value on their products. Now, what's happened in the last few years that to make things much worse than they were before is that the President of the United States obviously feels that he can freely abrogate and revoke property rights almost at will. And then he's wondering why corporations are building up cash on their balance sheets instead of investing in new plants and equipment and creating jobs with it. The reason why job creation has been slow is because it is very difficult for managers of firms and shareholders to calculate their after-tax return on their investment if the abrogation and revocation of property rights is going to become so blatant. Take a look at almost any industry. the Dodd-Frank banking law on regulation, it is an abomination. I mean, I just don't even know where to start. Sarbanes-Oxley, before that. They're going to tell companies all the things that they must do. Incidentally, I'm also the chief executive officer of two companies that are, one of them is domiciled outside the United States, and we are planning an initial public offering for one of those two companies, but we most certainly will not have the IPO in the United States. We'll almost certainly do it in Hong Kong or Singapore, and the major reason is it has to do with the freedom to make choices. I don't want to be dominated by regulations from kids who are just out of school working for the Justice Department or the SEC telling me what is appropriate and what is not. What should be appropriate is very simple. I should be able to pursue what I believe is in the best interest of my shareholders and let them reap the benefits through a higher share value. And if people don't like that, then let them go to some communist country instead.
Yeah, which the flow of humanity is always away from the places that restrict freedom the most to the places that provide you with the most freedom. And now we actually see the net immigration flow from places like Mexico have reversed, and people are going back to Mexico, although Asians are still coming here. So,
well, let me give you a concrete example here in South Africa, if I may.
Sure.
The dominant political party is called the African National Congress, the ANC, which is where Nelson Mandela was, and Thabo Mbeki, and so on. Right now, President Zuma is in charge. But they have also increased the role of government tremendously. And however, there are provincial governments, okay? And there are, the head of the province is called the premier, like the governor of New York State would be called the premier. And there's a woman who has that position here in Cape Town. Her name is Helen Zille, and she is with a party called the Democratic Alliance. Well, I'm an advisor to the Democratic Alliance on precisely these issues. And what's fascinating about it is they're following policies that are free market policies here, and there's been a mass migration from other parts of South Africa into the Western Cape because of the job opportunities that have been created. It is a magnificent experiment. I can hardly wait for the Economist magazine or the Financial Times of London to finally do a study and a report on exactly what's going on here in South Africa. The people are speaking with their feet, and it's exactly the point that you're making.
That is incredible, and I have to confess ignorance about that. I just thought the whole country was going down the tubes from collectivism, but it's refreshing that you can have this oasis of free markets in the middle of an economic desert. And this is what your mentor Milton Friedman said, that like Hong Kong was this bastion of economic freedom, and then right next to it was then Red China, which was an economic desert. And when you see examples within the same country, and I would argue you're seeing it in the U.S., Texas, Florida, all the states without income taxes are far outgrowing the states that are high tax states like New York, New Jersey, the People's Republic of California. And yet, these people, the liberal academia, the liberal media, they're blind to the fact that people will vote with their feet. Right now, I'm contemplating the move from New York to Florida because there's no income tax, and starting a business is as simple as clicking onto the Department of State's website in Florida, and within 5 minutes, as long as your credit card validation passes, you're in business. In New York, they want you to run ads in papers. It's hundreds of dollars. Who the heck needs it? And you're making a point that human freedom and economic freedom really do go hand in hand.
Well, you can have one without the other. You can. Economic freedom currently exists in China. What's interesting, incidentally, is that a University of Chicago professor in the Graduate School of Business there, the Boot School, his name was Merton Miller. He was also one of my professors when I was there. And he was the one, not Milton, it was he who went to China in the 1980s and met with Deng Xiaoping, who was the chairman of the party and the premier, and he said to him, if you follow free market policies, you will not believe the economic miracle that you will create. It took him a few years and many visits. Of course, Mark was a fantastic teacher, and his great student, Deng Xiaoping, finally listened to him and opened the southeastern part of China to open market, and of course everybody has seen the results. It is true that virtually everywhere in the world, you know, in Chile, Pinochet had been the dictator there, and when the Chicago boys, these were many of Milton's PhD students. When they completed their PhDs at Chicago, they went back to Chile, and they took over various positions in government, and they followed pure free market policies. Are you ready for a shock? The average rate of real growth in Chile over the last 30 years is 5% a year. It's unbelievable. It really is a spectacular place.
And that's real growth. That's not like the fake growth that we have
in
the U.S.
Real growth.
Yeah, which... Yeah.
Well, we're having problems. In the United States, we're having problems, but the good news is we have an election in just a few months, and if a listener to your program, even if they vote in absentia, as I will probably have to do, if they select the right candidate, we will move back toward free markets. I feel badly about one thing, incidentally, if I may just point it out,
sure,
regarding Governor Romney, and that is he does not seem to express himself in quite the way he should, and in part, the feeling I get is it has to do with his humility, not his arrogance, mm-hmm. and that is he doesn't want to take credit for a good deal of what took place in the investments that Bain Capital made. And
really?
Listen, Bain Capital made mistakes. We all make mistakes, but at least Bain Capital suffered the consequences of those mistakes. When Washingtonians make mistakes, they try to blame somebody else for it. Take a look. We had a banking crisis, an economic meltdown, the worst recession in maybe 60, 70 years. The question is, how come Bonnie Frank got off?
Yeah.
I never heard anybody criticizing him.
And Chris Dodd.
He was the one forcing the banks to make loans to unqualified borrowers and telling everybody not to worry. Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac will bail them out. And Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac did bail them out, unfortunately. And they went bankrupt first. And then the banks were still stuck with all those loans that they had not yet sold to Fannie and Freddie. And guess what? They went bankrupt. In other words, you don't rewrite the rules and laws of economics simply by wishing it. There are basic principles that stand the test of time. And if you're going to screw things up, all kinds of innocent people are going to pay a very bad price for it.
And, you know, the big problem, Professor Stern, is that the people that pay the price don't understand why they're paying that price. My family, on my father's side, went bust during the Great Depression. And to them, capitalism blew up. It was all capitalism's fault. They never understood the real cause, which was that monkeying with monetary policy and governmental intervention. All of FDR's policies prolonged the Great Depression, and I think we're in another Great Depression, and all of the governmental policies, Bush's, you could say Bush's Hoover, and Obama is FDR, all the policies that they're putting in place now, the only thing they're going to do is ensure and prolong the greater depression that we're suffering through now. And the only reason...
Let me just say one thing about that. We have to be careful. During the depression that your parents probably lived through, my parents lived through, the unemployment rate across the country averaged well over 20%. Right now, our unemployment rate is only about 8% in that range.
Well,
true, if you take those workers who cannot find work and they've given up and all of that, and they say these are discouraged workers and we should include them, let's assume the number was even as high as about, say, 12 or 13%.
I think it's 16.
If you took the same thing in the Depression, though, the numbers might have been closer to 30% or 35%. It was just horrible. And today, at least, people have the Internet and other things where they can search for job opportunities, not just in the United States, but even elsewhere. That communication was not available to your parents and grandparents, so that, in a sense, they're far better off today than they were then. But don't get me wrong. I believe that the policies that you're criticizing should be criticized, and I do so not just because of the issue of governance and individual liberty. What really matters to me is what happens to the average person in the society. I don't want people worse off today than they were 5 years ago or 10 years ago or longer. And unfortunately, under the Obama administration, You know, I'm sick and tired of listening to them blaming George Bush for everything. When is he finally going to take some responsibility for the really dopey decisions that he made? Can I tell you just very quickly? I was an advisor. I won't mention the name of the bank because I don't think they should get a benefit from it. But I'm an advisor to a major bank in England. It's one of the largest banks there. And they were having the same problems the American banks were having. And the CEO said, how fast can you get to London to talk with our board? So I went over there, and he said, listen, the equity has been wiped out. We made the same dopey loans that the Americans did, and we did it for many of the same reasons. So the question is, what do we do now? I said, well, if I were you, I would go to my shareholders and say, we lost your money. It's not any longer here. The only reason why our stock price is greater than zero is because there are tax loss carryforwards that have value in the society, and they're worth something greater than zero. But aside from that, we're just dead. We need to issue new equity in order to get back on our feet. On the other hand, we've got very talented people in the bank, lots of years of experience. You give us your money, we'll try to do the job we should have done all along, and we do apologize for what we lost. Well, believe it or not, that bank raised all the money it needed, and the result was it's one of the most successful banks in the world today, and it's based in the UK, okay, without mentioning its name. In the United States, the banks went to the government. The government offered TARP, it was called. It was a bailout through lending them money.
Mm-hmm.
The real reason why those banks go to their shareholders and also ask for money? The answer is the shareholders in the United States probably would have said to them, we'll put more money in, but we want you guys out. You're not the management that we want. We want somebody else. And so therefore, when the government said to the J.P. Morgan Chases and others, hey, we're going to provide you with funding, Bank of America, whatever, we're going to provide you with funding, they said, oh, sure, that's great. What was the real greatness of it? They didn't have to turn to their shareholders and say, listen, we need more money. And the shareholders would then say, we'll give you the money, but you're out. That did not happen. In almost no cases was the management tossed out. I believe the managements of most of those banks should have been replaced by competent people who would have tried with no history of disaster associated with them. All of these bankers simply knuckled under to Bonnie Frank and the people in Congress, and they did what they were told. Well, shareholder interests have to count for something.
Yeah, I totally agree with you. And the new management that was brought in those banks wouldn't have a vested interest in covering up the failures of the past, and they would have been purged out of the system.
Comment.
And
you're right.
You know, that's the key is that you really have to go on, take responsibility for what happened, explain to them why you're going to change it and why you're going to be better this time. And if the shareholders say adios, they say adios, and you're out of there. And nobody has suffered any consequences of the meltdown. Anyway, Professor Stern, we've got to get going now. We've reached the end of our time. But if people want to find out more about you, about the work that you're doing and your books, where should they go?
Well, we have a website called jstern@sternstewart.com, where the Stewart is spelled the Scottish way with an E-W. It's a firm that we have that results from the research that we've performed, and the website is called Stern Stewart & Company. It would describe many of these ideas.
All right. Well, hey, it's been a pleasure speaking with you. We'll talk to you again soon.